Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, KYKLOS IDEON, in cooperation with the NATO's Public Diplomacy Division, is going to organize a series of discussions for security and defense issues. Today, we start with the fundamental issues, the challenges of security and the challenges in NATO's southern flank. In today's discussion, participate very important speakers, co-speakers, whom I would like to welcome with a lot of pleasure and appreciation. But I start with Mrs. Ino Afenduli, which is a member in NATO's Public Diplomacy Division, a very well-known journalist who has spent many, many years in the Public Diplomacy Division of NATO, who is going to address our discussion. So, let me present to you the other participants, starting by the lady, the second lady of in our company, who is the very well-known journalist, who is a correspondent for Kathimerini and Skai TV, a non-resident senior fellow in Atlantic School, Mrs. Katerina Sokou, who is going to, not to be as a journalist, but as an analyst. And we would like to thank her for participating. Also, to ad honorum ambassadors participate, Ambassador Mr. Yannis Zepos, former Secretary General of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, former permanent representative of Greece to NATO, and under Martin Albright, the former Foreign Minister of United States, in a committee 10 years ago, when I was a defense minister, he participated in the new dogma of security in NATO. The big discussions those days had to do with the structure of the alliance. Also, Ambassador ad honorum Thrasyvoulos Stamatopoulos, former NATO Assistant Secretary General for Political Affairs, former permanent representative of Greece to NATO. I had closely worked with him, and he was for political affairs assistant secretary general. Therefore, we have two very well known people with a deep knowledge with us. And also Mr. Tzogopoulos Yorgos, fellow Begin Sadat Center and ELIAMEP, and a lecturer at Democritus University of Thrace. Therefore, I believe that we have the ability to approach from very different sides the issue. What is the issue? What are we talking about when we talk about the southern flank? It is the flank that we are interested in, the one that we belong to. It's the flank that has a reference center that is based in Naples. But we are not going to talk only for the southern flank of NATO, but for the southern area compared to the northern flank, which covers the geographic spectrum of NATO. In reality, we are going to talk about all the dimensions of our geographic identity: Southeastern Europe, the Balkans, the Mediterranean, and the Euro-Mediterranean cooperation, security problems in the Mediterranean, the role of Turkey in the area, of what is happening in the big in the countries in Syria and Libya, and what is happening there, and in the arrow of Middle East and Northern Africa. And of course, we are going to talk about issues that perhaps have to do with the land area, but the first topic of discussion is the sea, the Mediterranean, the issues that have to do with sea zones, also the exclusive economic zone and the continental shelf. Therefore, NATO, regarding with security issues in this extended geographic area, which is of great strategic importance, is addressing some problems because NATO is a political military organization, not only for defense, but of security, as we call it. It is an organization which is fundamental for the European security and the Euro-Atlantic cooperation. And I have to remind you that from the end of the First World War, the problem of the European security has always been non-stop Euro-American. It is of great importance to discuss with today's terms the European security and the initiatives of the European Union on the political field, the initiatives of the European Union with a common foreign affair policy and the common policy defense policy. How is it connected with NATO? If we can have a European security and European defense without NATO, or we have to admit that NATO is always going to be a pillar of the European security. Of course, we are going to talk about issues that we are interested in, that is to say the relationship between the relation between Europe and US, NATO and the European Union, Euro-Atlantic cooperation in general, the presence of the American military forces in Europe. We are going to discuss all these things in view of the end of the term in office of the US president, and in view of the American elections in November, and how long is the term in office of Mr. Trump is going to last? Is he going to be reelected, and what are the consequences going to be for the South? We are going to talk about the relations with Russia, but also the significant relations with China, the issues that have to do with our national priorities. First priority is, of course, the Cyprus issue. And because we are talking within the pandemic, after the COVID experience and the lockdown, and through the economic crisis, we are going to talk about cyber security, how climate change influences the dogma of security of NATO, the asymmetric threats, terrorism and immigration flows. I am going to close with an example, an experiential one. At the beginning of June, 9th of June, a Greek brigade, Spetses, who participates in the European operation in the Mediterranean, which is called Irini, peace, and checks the embargo in Libya, tried to control a ship that was accompanied by Turkish ships. A helicopter took off, who tried to do this control. The control was not made. The Turkish warships declared that the Tanzanian vessel was under their protection, and the Italian commander of the Irini operation gave the order to the Greek helicopter to depart. Just a few days, 10 days later, on the 17th of June, a French frigate who participates in the NATO operation in the same area for the same purpose, embargo of the Sea Guardian operation, for the embargo for illegal weapons, tried to do the same thing, and there we had the issue that the French had the certainty that not only the control was not made, but the French ship was blocked by the Turkish frigates. And that was extensively discussed in NATO, in the Council of the North Atlantic Alliance. France was not satisfied by the results and the the General Secretary said, and France departed the Sea Guardian operation because was dissatisfied. Let me remind you, in order to give more food for thought, that in the period of 2010-2011, 10 years ago, when I was defense minister and just before I go to the Ministry of Economics, there was an operation of NATO in Libya during the Arab Spring when Gaddafi was down. An operation that did not take place in the Libya land, but with sea and air means, an operation that members of NATO and other countries that wanted to participate, the United Arab Emirates, Sweden, and so on and so forth. But now, for many years, there is not only a presence of NATO neither in Syria nor in Libya, and potentially this absence of NATO, which is harmonized with the absence of the European Union as a political and strategic entity in Libya and in Syria, is that provides the field, the free field, for the intense military presence of Turkey, both in Syria and Libya. I stop here my introduction, which I hope was not very lengthy and perhaps a little bit attractive, and I will give the floor to my dearest Ino Afenduli.
Thank you very much for the invitation. And this pleasure is not only personal. I would like to convey the very warm address of my directors towards KYKLOS for this initiative, and for the discussions that are going to follow, very useful discussions, as all your public interventions have always been. And this initiative will bring us closer to some fruitful thoughts, some concerns that is related to the foreign affairs policy and our defense policy. It is very difficult to disagree, for someone to disagree with you in your introduction. And I will try to convey the same messages. First of all, I would like to say welcome to all the other guests. And I will start by being a bit unorthodox. We are experiencing a very historical era. It is an era of changes on the political stage, and this means that we have to prepare a big strategy. I will look into the past a bit in order to give the greater picture as we understand it. This greater picture, the milestone was 2014. And if a title might be given, a heading might be given, would be "The End of History Has Not Come." 2014, with the Ukrainian crisis and the Crimea issue, the West suddenly was awakened. Because in the previous 25 years, between the fall of the Berlin Wall up to 2014, we had a world whose main characteristic was the consolidation of specific things, stability through the expansion of the institutional expansion of NATO and the European Union. And this was a model that had successfully been implemented in the previous decades in the West. But in 2014, 2014, we realized that this transfer of the model to the East had its restrictions. And in order to focus on today's discussion, this great change in the international relations was not only related to the Eastern borders. The Eastern borders are safe because Russia knows very well where to stop. But what we see is that the southern borders and the southern flank, as we know it, as we call it, this area shows an increasing instability with very disconcerting features, characteristics. The Islamic State, Syrian war, Libyan war. So we see that in this southern flank, we have some ideas that we have about the peaceful coexistence of the states does not exist anymore. We have a reversal of the status quo. And of course, organizations such as NATO and the European Union cannot just be observant in this. They have undertaken the security and the safety of the states, of the countries. And this means action. But what we see in these two organizations, and here I will exercise some criticism, is that there are institutional tools that we have, and the real situation is completely different. Now, the European and the Western field had the tools that have been used for 70 years, but these tools are not sufficient enough to address the problems that occur today in the southern flank. And perhaps this mismatch between the institutions and the reality led the president of France, Mr. Macron, to state, we all know what he stated, but there is this situation that is used by leaders that are not democratic leaders in order to expand their power in areas such as in the Mediterranean, for example. I think that this is the heart of the problem. And of course, I still believe that both the European Union and the NATO are very strong institutions, strong organizations. They have institutional capital, they have very strong member states, and they have to respond. But if I wanted to be honest, I wouldn't say that we have all the answers. Thank you very much for the floor, for the opportunity to speak. Thank you very much, Mrs. Afedouli. I can only say that I have experienced this curve that you mentioned, the period 2010-2014. In the presence of Mr. Stamatopoulos, I was in Lisbon in the summit meeting. And the Russian president, Mengelev, was there. And Putin participated as well. In Cardiff later on, we had again this kind of Cold War. So things change very quickly. And what has also changed after the Trump election is that the existence, the consciousness of the West is questioned. President Macron talked about the brain dead NATO. Trump talked about the question, the existence of NATO. But here we have to talk about something else as well, specifically about the South. We have not discussed what the Arab Spring meant. We haven't talked about this. We haven't discussed the consequences and we didn't have the suitable approach to this phenomenon. Now I give the floor to Mr. Zepos and then to Mr. Stamatopoulos. Mr. Zepos, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. Good evening to everybody. And thank you, President, for this meeting. A lot of things have been discussed already by you and Mrs. Afendouli. We have cooperated many years in NATO. You mentioned in 2010 and Russia and the position of Russia and how it presented itself in 2010, because in the summit meeting in Lisbon is accepting the new defense dogma. In these 2 years where this dogma was being prepared, it was interesting for one to see that Russia, with various, allow me to say, games in inserted commas, sometimes pleased, sometimes not, nevertheless was always interested in working with the NATO that had visioned it in a different way from the previous NATO. Therefore, cooperated with the Commission pressure that they had we had come to the limits of tolerance of Russia. And I think I remember from the moment that we went in Ukraine and we had gone to the universities and tried to convince the youth of the importance of NATO and Ukraine to approach NATO. It was a complete failure. I understood as a Greek, who possibly we understand a little bit better the Russians, that we had come to the limits of tolerance of the Russians regarding of where we could go forward to the limits of NATO. I will stop here in order to leave Mr. Stamatopoulos to go forward. And he will give us his own idea. So, Mr. Stamatopoulos, you have the floor. I would like to thank in my turn for the invitation, and secondly, I would like to thank you, President, and Ms. Afendouli for the excellent introduction that you have made, in which I will base in order to make my first intervention. Mrs. Afendouli mentioned 2014 as a very significant year, and it was indeed, but allow me to go back in 2008, I believe that the starting point was in 2008 with the summit meeting in Bucharest, in which, apart from the well-known for us decision regarding the enlargement of the European Union for Serbia, said also that Georgia and Ukraine will become members of NATO. The decision was that, yes, they were going to be members of NATO. Putin was present in Bucharest, not in the specific meeting of the Euro-Atlantic Council, but with the other member states, and I remember him being there in the corridors and the electricity that this decision produced in the Russian team. August 2008, Russia invaded, in a sense, Georgia. We tend to forget this because, among others, the Georgia position was not the best and gave a step forward to the Russians, but in any case, the turning point was that place. 2014 is extremely important. I would like to thank Mr. Putin because he did it a few months after he had done that, after he had taken the Assistant Secretary General for Political Affairs those days, and I helped towards the shaping up of the policy of those days. Crimea is important for many reasons, because it signified the revision of the international system as we knew it until then. It is important because it is about the first taking over of European grounds, and Russia had signed the Memorandum of Budapest, based on which Ukraine had accepted to submit the nuclear weapons that had in exchange for the promise for safeguarding its integrity as it were, including Crimea. And among the participants in this memorandum was Russia that had signed it. Therefore, we see an overturning of the value system of the international affairs as we knew them until then. As regards NATO, and I agree 100% with what Ms. Afedouli said regarding the contradiction of the institutional framework and the reality, I believe that NATO is a victim as well of the general revision of the system and the revision of the gravity that the international formations have, and the diplomacy that was taking place until then. And this has happened with the European Union, and we saw what happened with COVID-19 when it started. But the alliance became more vulnerable in this phenomenon because it's about a governmental organization. And I think a huge role has been played, as you said, President, the attitude of the American president, because the United States was the cohesive power in the alliance, and when this power devaluates NATO, although the president of the US has really minimized his attitude, he has called it in a different way nowadays. But anyway, in order to finish what Ms. Afedouli said about Eastern Mediterranean, I agree that there is a huge problem there. I'm not saying that we have to the storm yet, but there is a series of problems which we don't know how they are going to appear, and if they appear in a time collectively, perhaps things we are going to be difficult. We have the relationship between Turkey, Greece, Israel and Cyprus. We have Egypt, which Egypt is a country in a vulnerable situation, both financially and on a social cohesion issue, for which we already had what happened to against Mubarak, and we don't know what's going to happen there. We have Israel as well. If Mr. Netanyahu goes forward to the annexation of the Palestinian grounds, as he has said, this will have consequences and impacts internally in Israel, but also in Jordan as well, and possibly impacting the relations of Israel with some countries, although I believe that the Gulf countries have underground relationships with Israel, but in the internal public opinion of the Arab countries, we don't know how it's going to be presented. Also, we have the Iran issues, the Iraq issue, instability period. For Syria, there is no need to say anything. We have the Lebanon, who is having great problems. Therefore, the whole area, the whole field of the Eastern Mediterranean is facing problems, either existing or potential ones, which need to be addressed without being addressed so far. Thank you, Ambassador. Now, let's go to our researchers, Mrs. Sokou and Mr. Tzogopoulos. Let's go towards the question, what is the added value of NATO in the issues that are critical and crucial for Greece? What NATO could do in the Mediterranean regarding with the Turkish rhetoric, the threats, and if Turkey creates a problem in the operation of NATO, what added value NATO can provide in Libya and Syria? What is happening in the cooperation of the European Union and NATO because of Cyprus, who is a member of the European Union, but always creates problems in the two organizations because of the Turkish attitude? Let's see how these things from problems could develop into more productive approaches in order to increase the level of security in an area which is encircled by many problems. Let's start from Mrs. Katerina Sokou, who will give us the American point of view, because she experiences there by being living there.
Thank you very much for the invitation. It is very honorary for me to participate in such a panel with people that know very well NATO and the Greek foreign affairs policy. I will try to give you the American perspective about all the things that were put forward, the way that the USA see this region in the national defense policy of the US regarding the Mediterranean. Always they try to have a strategic competition with Russia and China. And this is related to this region as well. And this is why the US, they wanted to fight instability in terms of terrorism. And also they try, in theory at least, to have this competitive strategy towards Russia. And it is characteristic in the EEST-GR draft that is now the law of the American state. It was approved by the Congress. They promote the three-member cooperation between Greece, Israel, and Cyprus in order to supplement this American power that they lose in the area. Of course, looking towards Russia and China, as I said before, at the same time. We should never forget the statements of President Trump regarding NATO. NATO is obsolete. That's how he started, without any kind of reason for existence. But of course, this has changed now. Now, President Trump realizes the importance of NATO when he speaks, but
σε σχέση με το
πόσο ξαναδεύουμε για την αμυντική συνεργασία. Some aggressive attitude towards specific countries and the money that they spend for NATO. Last year I was in Washington in a celebration for the 70 years of NATO and Germany was attacked for the deficit in its contribution. Mike Pence, and of course they started talking about withdrawing the American troops in Germany. And this, of course, will affect the safety and the security in the area. We don't know what will happen. President Trump has said that some of these troops will come back to the States, some others will go to other countries, Poland, for example, and we don't know whether this will support the southern flank. There is some kind of insecurity here in this issue. And it's a bit ironical, a president that goes against Obama policies, goes towards Asia, the Asian pivot that stopped suddenly with the Russian invasion in Crimea in 2014, and of course with the Syrian war, etc., led President Obama to look towards Europe and our region. Of course, in a different way than the past. Anyway, we see that the psychological gap that has been created by the rhetorics of President Trump has accelerated the procedures for the development of a European policy, defense policy. There's information about the need for a European defense cooperation, and of course, this will be extremely interesting to see what this will mean for our neighborhood and whether this policy will be able to replace NATO and how this again will be understood in the White House and the response of the White House. Thank you very much for the US point of view and the comments that you made. Now, Mr. Tzogopoulos, Germany. As Mrs. Sokou said, is an excellent example, the biggest country, member state of the European Union that gives huge amounts of money in its real economy after the coronavirus pandemic, the country that is the leader and gives a direction for the construction of the European economy. This Germany that wants to have the initiative in Turkey-Greek relationships and is threatened by the US with sanctions, not for South Stream, this has been forgotten now, we're talking about North Stream 2. So, Germany is indirectly threatened, the participating companies are directly threatened, and at the same time the Germans protest because they see that the American troops might be withdrawn that are in Germany after the Second World War. These two images, these two pictures give us an idea about the limits of Germany and the European Union when we talk about defense cooperation. I'm not talking about defense industry, but defense cooperation with risk, assuming of risks as well. Thank you very much. I will make a general comment. You and the other speakers have put forward very important issues. And I think that it is extremely significant to discuss all these issues in Greece under the aegis of NATO's Public Diplomacy Division. And this is very important for EKKLOS, your organization, and Greece as well, to get away from the very narrow national interests, but look into international issues as well, in cooperation with NATO. Another thing that I would like to say is that when we talk about the South, the current situation is very important, and I would like to give emphasis not only on the Greek interests, but in general, because we are still in the middle of a pandemic that we don't know when it will be completed, when it will be over, and the key question is whether this coronavirus crisis will lead to safety and security crisis. In Israel, in the last months, of course, as you can understand, the enemies of Israel did not say that due to the coronavirus we are going to stop the hostilities towards the country. What else can happen in the wider area of the Mediterranean? And I'm not going to repeat what you have said, the previous speakers have said. I would like to give an example from the sub-Saharan zone and Africa in general, due to coronavirus, violence, insecurity for food, and all these issues come to the limelight. Immigration flows, refugees that are going to increase due to the financial problems created by the pandemic, are going to create many more challenges in the South, and this is something that the NATO will be asked to address in the next months. Of course, there are specific bodies, specific tools that exist, but now we're talking about a new context. But I really believe that when we have events like meetings like this one, and with more research, NATO will be able to approach the conditions in the Mediterranean. I'm talking about the Mediterranean Dialogue Tool, and of course, build a trust. We're talking about a region which is very different from the southern flank. Mediterranean is a very specific issue, and we can contribute to finding solutions with research, many more articles, etc. Thank you very much.
I would like now to go to another issue. More specifically, the accession of Western Balkan countries to NATO. North Macedonia was accessed after the Prespes agreement, Montenegro as well. We solved the problem with North Macedonia for many years. Now, what is the practical importance of these developments? How important is the participation in NATO? The fact that is to say that apart from Serbia, the area is accessed in NATO. Of course, we have Bosnia-Herzegovina, but we have a lot of partners, allies in NATO. We have all these problems. We have pending issues with Cyprus, threats for drilling into the economic exclusive zone of Cyprus. We have a tension between Greece and Turkey on the sea zones, and we have a rhetoric and to see if NATO can help. I remind you that when we had real operations in NATO 2011 in Libya, the island of Limnos participated in the planning, because the exceptions that are included in the North Lurals and the Aegean have to do with exercises, not real war. Limnos is included in the European planning of the European Union because we do not have any objections. What could NATO do? There was an operation of NATO regarding the immigration flows and the surveillance of the borders, but this has already been forgotten. Frontex, which is a European entity, is present. Regarding Libya, where we see the contradiction that exists, that we have a recognized government and at the same time to have doubts and conflicts, a proxy civil war that takes huge dimensions, Syria, in order to talk about the open issues and what Mr. Tzogopoulos mentioned, that start from the Middle East to the issue of Yemen, for example. What could NATO do? And the question is, perhaps the countries that are in power, have power, from United States to Italy and from France to Turkey, perhaps they overcome this, perhaps they are indifferent for the consensus that this organization that is called NATO is based, and what has been left from the strategic theory that led to the direct and simultaneous accession of Greece and Turkey in NATO since 1952, which was the first enlargement of the alliance with these two countries. I would like to see in this second round of discussion these issues or whatever else you think. Ms. Safedul, if you want to make a comment or you want to speak in the end, I don't know. Dear President, whatever you think, these are very, very important issues that you have put forward. Look, I believe that as I insinuated in my introductory intervention, there is an institutional non-integration which, if we have the interstate willingness, this gap can be filled, because we should not forget that NATO is the total number of countries that are members. On the other hand, although we want to be objective and open-minded in a dialogue, we should not forget that NATO right now is the only, on a global scale, political and military power at the same time. Irrespective of all the other comments that are acceptable, yes, it remains a machine that includes the political bodies and the military capability. As I said in my introduction, we have neglected, for many reasons which possibly we don't have the time to mention, political, historical, cultural possibly, we have neglected the South. Why? Because in the South it would be very difficult to bring the example that was applied in the Central and Eastern Europe and the Western Balkans. But this would not create any problems, and I would like the ambassadors to say that it couldn't possibly have a more decisive intervention on the level of sea operations, on a maritime cooperation, something that NATO recognizes through the General Secretary, that can only take place with the European Union. I think this is a field that both organizations can agree on most issues, that is to say, to try and find a common target, because the problems are common. The problems that are exported from Africa have to do with all the European countries. Therefore, we should have a common way of addressing and tackling the issue. Let's go to the dearest ambassadors, Mr. Zepos. Mr. President, I will go back to what you said just a little while ago. The first enlargement of NATO in 1952 for Greece and Turkey. I would like to say that NATO of those days and 10, 20 years later, had much simpler issues to address compared to the ones today, and possibly must address and tackle in the future. The involvement in the Mediterranean, North Africa, Sahel, as Mr. Tzogopoulos said, that it is a pressure. All these things show that we are going to a new direction, that NATO is called upon to act, but it does not have the familiarization that it has, because the Mediterranean dialogue was not as fruitful as we expected. And let us bear in mind that all the big countries of the Eastern Mediterranean, Egypt, for example, everybody is very careful with their balances, not to be exposed to NATO, but at the same time to use NATO whenever necessary. Undoubtedly, we have a very significant issue in North Africa. And I will go back to something you mentioned, that in 2010, when the decision was taken in Élysée with Sarkozy to have the aerial and sea attack in Libya, we have a happy war NATO, because I was in the room that day with a cheering and a round of applause. There were also Gulf countries present. Therefore, there was a tremendous willingness for action, war action in Libya. Personally, I believe that took place in the wrong time, because it was through the Arab Spring. Perhaps better ways could be found those days, but that means that it has left a footprint, this intervention in 2010. Therefore, our intervention in the Mediterranean, and I think today's NATO takes this into consideration, and always takes into account in order to see in a new era, 10 years after 2010, how we can manage the issues of the Mediterranean with great attention, so that it will not cause reactions from countries with which it would like to cooperate. And this perhaps leads us that since NATO has advanced after the Balkans, it moved towards North Africa, Mediterranean, reached Afghanistan. I leave this for later on. I have the impression that we see if it has a wider future role that could play as a security organization for the future. But today, that is called upon to address the Mediterranean issues, is a very subtle handling of the situation in a difficult period of time with difficult people. Before I give the floor to Mr. Stamatopoulos, because we are talking about Libya and to have forgotten Syria, the last official political action of NATO after a request by Turkey, 28th of February, just before the lockdown, because of the COVID-19, 28th of February 2020, I repeat, was to express the solidarity of the alliance to Turkey after the in-clip bombarding. Therefore, NATO is present in Syria through via Turkey. On the other hand, we have Russia, we have Iran. In Libya, we have more active participation of other NATO countries, Italy, France, but again, we have Russia. With the private Wagner army, we have this war by representatives, and we have Turkey again to calling again the Security Council of the United Nations, and at the same time we have an embargo that is violated by Turkey. We have two operations, one European, one from NATO, which seem to be ineffective on the sea field. Therefore, I give the floor to Mr. Stamatopoulos, the ambassador.
Thank you very much. Now, as regards the Syria affair, it is exactly as you said. Yes, NATO was there in the theater of operations. Because it had agreed to be part of the coalition of the willing.
Τα οποία εκπαιδεύουν την περιοχή και νούμερα
the
βασικά στον
μονάριο χώρο της
Τουρκίας. Η έκφραση αλληλεγγύης προς την Τουρκία
δεν θα έλεγα ότι είναι απόλυτα αυτοματισμός, αλλά πάσης
όταν σύμμαχος έρχεται στο
absolutely correct, but when an ally asks for the solidarity of the ally of the other allies towards a third party, it is a tradition of NATO. And there is the tradition of offering this help, and of course, weapons are given. Don't forget that the Spanish have offered the Patriots. The Germans have withdrawn their own, but this is a tradition when an ally asks for help. And now about Libya, things are quite different. NATO was involved in 2011. My impression is mainly because the enthusiasm that existed was of French origin, English-French origin, enthusiasm that did not have the means that were required in order to have to perform, to carry out such an operation that was accepted by the UN. And anyway, the Americans agreed and all the others, and this was transferred to NATO. Germany, don't forget, said that we are not going to react, but we are not going to participate in this operation. Now about the Balkans, and I'll come back to the Mediterranean, because you mentioned the Balkans. The added value is small, is more symbolical. It is not defense added value. And with the accession of Montenegro, the entirety of the Adriatic participated, and because the Russians wanted to have a naval base in Montenegro, this excluded this possibility. A parenthesis here. Don't forget that the support to Turkey has also a Russian aspect inside it, because according to some, this is very important. And when we see what's going on in Libya, and don't forget that many people connect the idea of the Libyan affair with Russia as well, because many believe that Russia encourages Turkey in its policy and the political affairs in the area. But I don't believe that this is true, and we have seen the way that Turkey behaves, and I don't think that Russia's interference in Libya plays a very important role, and we don't know where it will end about NATO in the south. As Mrs. Afentouli mentioned, the problem is that NATO now is in a way fragmented. The Russian threat is described as a traditional continuation. It is something that we understand more. The South, the affairs of the South are more complicated and are not of interest for the Northern allies. the southern allies are to blame as well, because they do not have a cohesive strategy in order to pressurize, exercise pressure and push the solidarity ideas. I agree with you that NATO-EU cooperation in the Mediterranean field is of crucial importance. The challenges are such that NATO cannot deal them, cannot handle them on its own. The European Union started the cooperation with NATO in the Warsaw Summit for many, many reasons. This has not succeeded. And also, don't forget the Cyprus affair. Turkey would like the European Union to have a different approach from the European Union in relation to Cyprus. Don't forget also the White House change of approach towards the European Union. This might change after the American elections, but we don't really know, and we don't know the impact that the elections will have on NATO. Don't forget that Greece on February 28 participated in the support statement declaration of Turkey for Syria. Of course, there is the Haftar issue and what the fronts there mean and how complicated they are and the potential that they have, because the decisive issue is the Russian parameter. And I would like to hear the views of Mrs. Sokou, the comments of Mrs. Sokou, what will happen in the future if we have a re-election of President Trump or not.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Stamatopoulos gave a good pass regarding these issues, but let me go back to the critical cooperation between NATO and the European Union in the Mediterranean. If President Trump is re-elected, we are going to have the continuation of the same status by putting in stress the European alliances. But also it will give the initiation for other powers to go forward in the area. If Joe Biden is elected, it's definite that the emphasis of the American security on Russia and China will remain. However, there will be, and this is declared in the pre-electorate agenda, going back, a return to the multilateral cooperation. The psychological gap of the alliance will be made an effort to be healed with common initiatives for evaluation and assessment of the threats from Biden, without having the same burden with Russia, but the effort of approach of the American approach to regarding Turkey by trying to keep it in the West. The Vice President Biden has a clear Philhellenic profile compared to President Trump, who, yes, he has his approaches and his close relationship with the homogenia, the American, the Greek Americans. That's why I would say that that the challenges for a common attitude will remain with the Biden presidency in the southern flank of NATO and the achievement of cooperation with the European Union. And I think this has to do with the problematic role of Turkey in Libya and how essentially this creates problem with other members of the alliance, not only with Greece, but with Italy as well. In a degree, I would say that I wonder, depending on the reaction of NATO in this French-Turkish conflict, if this will define the attitude of the European Union or it will have a more dynamic attitude towards Turkey, especially in the immigration issue. Therefore, I consider that this instability remaining in the area will put the European countries of the alliance and the forces of the area in front of difficult choices, and depending on their management, they can undermine NATO and perhaps the European Union as an entity. Let me remind you that the Mediterranean is our sea. It's the European sea. For the Europe, it's of existential importance. Now, Mr. Tzogopoulos, thank you very much. If you could tell us a few things regarding the Israel-NATO relationship and how Israel, in its planning for the developments in the area, takes into consideration the NATOIC parameter, and how all these things can be reflected in the Mediterranean in general. The relationship of Israel and NATO is very, very good. And the contacts mainly are taking place in the framework of the Mediterranean dialogue, since Israel is one of the countries that participate in the regular contacts with the member states of the alliance. Now, from the Israeli point of view, what is interesting is to show to the alliances that their security problems and sensitivity with Iran must be addressed by the alliance mostly, because if a crisis in Iran could have impacts in the Mediterranean basin. But in no case Israel would like to have a more active cooperation with NATO, because due to its autonomy and independence and the very good relationships that it has with the United States, has the ability to undertake the military interventions that it wants to have in order to protect its own national security. That's why COVID-19, they have not stopped at any period of time the attacks against Hezbollah targets within Syria. But there is the ability of cooperation, but especially with issues that have to do with the national security of this country itself. I think a very pragmatistic approach, which we should always take into consideration. I would now propose to spend the few minutes that we have left in today's developments. I will describe them very briefly. They have to do mainly with the European Union. We have the discussions between Greece and France for a new defense cooperation on the basis of the possible French frigates for the needs of the Greek Navy. We have the tension between France and Turkey. We have the German presidency in these 6 months in the European Union, and the ambition of Germany to undertake initiatives that are not restricted only in Western Balkans, but they have to do with the Mediterranean as well, and they have to do with the Greek-Turkish relationships, the possibility of the initiation of a dialogue, and possibly the Cyprus issue. And also, yesterday we had a visit of the High Commissioner and High Representative and Vice President of the European Commission, of Mr. Borrell, in Ankara. Correll Çavuşoğlu statements. Çavuşoğlu comments of how he sees the Greek relations in the Aegean by mentioning 1976 Port Protocol of Verne in Mediterranean through the November 2019 in the United since 2019. Of how they see the Eastern Mediterranean just before the MOU Erdogan-Saraz was announced. And of course, we have the insistent reference in the need of a European intervention or mediation to solve the problems of the Turkish Cypriot community from the exploitation of the exclusive economic zone of hydrocarbons profits, because also we have the natural gas prices and the prospects that exist does not really mean that we are going to have more drilling there, or as it has been said by international media today. I would like to have an estimation of the initiatives of the big European countries that constitute the main countries of the European countries and the basic pillar of NATO, in connection with our own interests and problems in the Greek-Turkish relations in the Mediterranean and the Cypriot and the Cyprus. Ino, would you like to make a comment? Very briefly, thank you very much. I think that every process of dialogue and conflict resolution is welcome. This has been declared by the Secretary Generals. There is no process of resolving conflicts in the alliance. Perhaps many analysts is a gap. I don't know how this can be bridged in a future institutional reform, but in any case, I think it's to the interest of the whole area, but mainly Greece, because geography is not going to change, to have a good relationship with Turkey based on rules. So every effort for dialogue, if successful, will be very welcomed. The decisive phrase is based on rules. That is to say, the international framework of legality, which is difficult in practice. Mr. Zepos. Mr. President, I think you said two magic words. German presidency. I think it is a huge opportunity of Mrs. Merkel, because possibly it's the final stage of her political career, and having understood perhaps where the problems stand, especially with our problem, I think she has a very clear point of view of where the problems between Greece and Turkey stand. And I have the impression that she will use this period of the German presidency, because undoubtedly she is in good communication with Macron and the other European countries. And I think they will try and find the rules. Let me use this word, says the speaker, the rules that a dialogue could go forward, a constructive dialogue between Greece and Turkey, and will bring results, and without threats, without any verbalism, and try to be fruitful. I am looking forward to this German presidency, and I am thinking that it is a very good opportunity, taking into consideration that the phone calls that we have from governments and heads of states are not so important as in previous decades. I think it is a good opportunity to help with the German presidency to try and find ways of communicating and find the rules based on which two neighbors, whether we like it or not, must find a way to live together without violent conflicts. Mr. Stamatopoulos. Mr. President, as regards the defense cooperation between France and Greece, I don't know what is involved in the discussions. France is a country that is really interested in the area, especially in Libya, apart from the Eastern Mediterranean. Let us not forget that countries that play a role in Libya, like Egypt and the United Arab Emirates, have very good relationships with France, because France is selling them military equipment that has a military base in Abu Dhabi. As regards the common statements in the common between Borrell and Tzavusoglu, in the off-camera discussion that we had, we need to analyze it very, very deeply and seriously. Of course, in the measure that these statements were serious. On Monday, there's going to be a discussion between in the Council of the Foreign Ministers, and Mr. Borrell will be the president and will interpret his statements. Let us see what his interpretation will be and if something was insinuated in the statements that were made by the two men. I think we need some clarification there. And as regards the involvement of the European Union in the rights of the Turkish Cypriots, let us first see if the European Union would accept to do something like that, because this was said by Mr. Tzavusoglu. But if this was took place with some success, let's say, and closed the issue on behalf of future separation of profits, perhaps it would take away from Turkey a part of their argument, of their arguments. Under the condition, of course, that any result would be connected with successful and acceptable solution of the Cyprus issue. Or at least So we have to be very careful on this issue. As regards the German presidency and their willingness, I think we have to be very careful. I wouldn't be against the presidency of the European Union. The 6 months presidency is to take some positions, some points of view, and make some efforts. In Bucharest, when we're in the final council for taking the decision for the Skopje issue, one of the Balkan allies proposed to have in the final declaration that these parties to conclude the negotiations. And my address to the Prime Minister was to accept it, but to include the both parties, because we are not both parties with alliance and outside the alliance. I would say that we are not the same, the members of the European Union and the country that is a candidate to be accessed in the European Union. Therefore, all these things, both the German presidency and ourselves, we have to be extremely careful if this is going to be if this is going to go forward. Well, until the Cyprus issue can be solved, the European Union could play a role in order to safeguard the just distribution of terms and conditions from the exploitation of the hydrocarbon age from the Cypriot exclusive economic zone, respecting this Cypriot democratic state, which is a member state of the European Union and NATO. If this can be safeguarded, perhaps the tension may be decreased. That's what I meant when I said that it will take some power away, take away some of the arguments from Turkey. This move that perhaps may take place now is something that could have taken place a long time ago. That is to say, years ago, an account could be opened many years ago, where we could have taken away from Turkey the criticism that this has not taken place. That was in the proposals of the Greek Cypriot side to have this account. It was proposed by Mr. President Anastasiadis. The new element now is the guarantee factor of the European Union with respect to its member and the international personality of the democracy of Cyprus by providing possibly a solution in the framework as we have stated for many years, and it's the one that is talked about by the Cypriot side. On my side, I would say to say that regarding the prospects of the German presidency for an intermediary role, because this period coincides with a difficult period for the United States, we are going to have the elections, this transition period, whether we have the re-election of Trump or Vice President Biden, this is going to be a period that is a little bit unstable in the United States. Therefore, it is it is time to exploit the European alliances in order to manage the next difficult period of time, because we don't really know what Turkey is going to exploit to take advantage of this period. And also, in the meantime, I think the Greek multi-level foreign policy with the tripartite cooperation in the area and the bigger activation in NATO and in cooperation with the European Union and France are a way to approach this period. From my personal experience, I know that generally speaking, any big effort or campaign of mediation by European Union or other country and the United States perhaps may bring reaction to both countries, and especially in Greece and in Turkey, I think. Therefore, I think these things take place behind closed doors and without announcements and statements in public. Definitely, of course, all the European initiatives are welcomed and the presidency can play a role. Let us not forget that the role of the United States is decisive. Let us not forget the wider relations and the recent experiences. The big margin for initiatives from Europe that was left by the United States in the crisis of ex-Yugoslavia has not filled us with pleasant memories, because a map with huge uncertainties map in the Balkans that we have now. And the same applies in the Mediterranean with a wider sense, including the arrow of North Africa. Therefore, we have always keep our feet on the ground. Mr. Tzogopoulos, what is your opinion as a younger analyst? If I can put more emphasis on France regarding compared to Germany, President Macron, I think, comprehends fully the geopolitical issues. And I'm not saying that because it is a very good period for the Greek-French relations, but he puts on the agenda critical questions, for example, the one of disarmament. The ambassadors of in Paris last year in Paris, I told them that Europe must play a role for the nuclear agreement. A few days ago we had in Vienna, Washington and Moscow discussions, and Mr. Macron wants to put Europe in the geopolitical field, and also the points of view that he has for Russia, and he is in favor of dialogue, and I think it is worthwhile to analyze his proposals more in depth. Now, the possibility of cooperation, I will not talk about the bipartite issue. We have the East Med Cas Forum, Greece, Israel, Cyprus, Palestinian Authority, Jordan, Italy are members of this forum. There are rules, as Mrs. Safedouli said earlier on, and because it is for the interest of the United States, the enlargement of this area, the countries that are not participating, Lebanon and Turkey, to see whether they can undertake this rule and have a bigger cooperation. And you mentioned earlier on, very rightly so, that because of COVID-19, we don't know what is hoping to happen with the future drillings. These are issues that have to be discussed from all the Mediterranean countries, and through this forum, I think we can, based on rules, solve and discuss these problems. Yes, this has to do with Egypt as well, because although we are talking about East Med, which is East Med Act is something different, which is an American law that Mrs. Sokou mentioned, and not East Med as an economic project, because here we have a doubt as the financial sustainability of the small pipe that will connect from Aphrodite in Cyprus democracy to the stations of liquefied gas of Egypt. That is very close, not in the Peloponnese, as the prospect is for East Med pipeline and so on. Allow me to close this very, very interesting and fruitful discussion that rocks the boat and gives answers to the questions, opens up and creates challenges and food for thought. Turkey will be pressed, and Greece will be pressed in order to participate in a dialogue. And this dialogue, I think, must start from what has been institutionalized, standardized according to the sea law, from what we cannot go forward without a dialogue, which is to set the borders of the sea zones and also the and the continental shelf and all the countries that do not participate in the sea law, with Turkey and Israel, but they are committed by the international laws and the international sea law. This has to do with this Monte Conte agreement. We have to have agreements and with some discussions that are anticipated by the sea maritime law. We have expressed our preference for the Hague. Without a decision and without marginalization, you cannot have full exploitation of your rights on the continental self and the exclusive economic zone. The time goes by, although 46 years have gone by, and the oil is and natural gas lose their own value. We are talking about abolition of oil, and after 25, 30 years, natural gas is not going to be used. We are only going to talk about renewable energy sources. Therefore, if because time is going by, we have to move faster, and as we say that for us it is a priority based on maritime law, because this is the axis of our policy, and this is irrelevant to all the other issues that we call them violations of international law based on the Turkish rhetoric. We are not going to talk about disarmament, or but we can talk about the constructive measures of aerial and sea trust measures. And also decisive is the development on Cyprus in order to solve the problems of the rights of the Cypriot Turkish minority, which is an entity of the Cypriot constitution from 1960. And of course the hydrocarbonates of Cyprus. We have to say something that is specific, constructive, integrated, which is addressing Urbi et already addressed to the European Union and the other countries of the Mediterranean, which are nearby, neighboring ones, and they participating in this marginalization, and that's what we talk about national national sovereignty. We have specific sovereign rights that are being exercised fully when we have marginalization. Otherwise, we have rhetoric but not practical results, or we have preliminary actions. Therefore, the discussion for NATO and the challenges of security in the South may help us see issues that have to do with NATO itself, directly the European Union, the international community, but for us are issues for our national and financial interests, mainly national interests, by starting by the Cyprus issue, which is an international issue of invasion. It is of Greek initiative, and Greek initiative is the marginalization of the sea zones, with not only with Italy, but with Albania, Libya, Turkey. Thank you very much for your participation. Dear Mrs. Afetouli, give our regards to your division. We will have more experiences in the framework of our cooperation. Mr. Zepos, Mr. Stamatopoulos, Mr. Tzogopoulos, and Mrs. Sokou, thank you very much for your contribution. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, thank you very much because you had... You were so kind to follow our discussion and debate. Thank you very much indeed.